Have you ever dreamed of doing something for a long time? Prepared for it? Created a vision in your head? But when you finally got there, it was not how you imagined it would be. My introduction to being a doctor was just like that. Not at all what I was expecting. In 2020, just after I graduated as a general practitioner in Brazil, I started working as a frontline doctor in a dedicated COVID facility. An entire stadium had been transformed into a makeshift treatment center. There were no rooms, just rows of beds, lined up next to each other, with patients laying side by side. When I first stepped into the place, I remember feeling like I had just walked into a scene from a war movie, one with field hospitals. Never in my wildest dreams did I imagine I would work in a place like that when I got into medical school, but life happened, and there I was, facing my new reality. My routine was pretty much the same every day. I would arrive, leave my bags in the staff room, and head to the preparation area to properly suit up and protect myself before entering the isolation zone. I would wash my hands, put on a gown, a cap, two pairs of gloves, a mask, and a face shield. Finally, I was ready to start working. Each morning, I would receive a list of the patients I was responsible for. I would talk to them, examine them, and adjust treatment plans. After that, I would call their families to update them on the loved one's conditions. Those conversations were often the most challenging part of my days. The limited amount of time and multiple layers of personal protective equipment created a barrier that made it easier to ignore my body's basic needs. If I needed to drink water or use the toilet, I had to carefully remove each layer in a very specific order to avoid contaminating myself, and by extension, my family, who I was living with at the time. As a result, more often than not, I would just push through and ignore what my body was telling me. I was immersed in a setting where helping and supporting everyone else while neglecting myself was considered normal. And to be honest, I wouldn't think much about it at the time. I just kept repeating the same routine day after day. Now, you don't have to be in healthcare to recognize that in the fast-paced routine of today's world, taking a moment to pause, slow down, and set boundaries to reflect on life seems impossible, or even selfish to some. After all, the culture of you can handle everything has created heroes and heroines. So strong and tireless, we give so much to others that we don't realize how exhausted we are until we hit a breaking point. In 2021, as things were slowly starting to get better, I began to notice this staggering amount of mental health issues emerging. Among patients who were battling and navigating their own journeys of recovery or grieving their losses, among the healthcare providers standing beside me, and within myself. The things that used to bring me joy were no longer that interesting. Even though I was exhausted when I was home from work, I could not sleep. And when I finally did, I would wake up at night with nightmares and heart palpitations. I was feeling very guilty and disappointed with myself for feeling like that, for not being as strong as I was expected to be. None of us were immune to the emotional impact of what we were facing. After all, beneath all those protective layers, we were all just humans. In this context, I started thinking about something. The way I was trained to be a doctor was centered around making a diagnosis and treating this diagnosis. But then I started to ask myself, when it comes to mental health, is this approach really enough? Research from 2021 suggests that up to 60% of patients with psychiatric disorders show limited or no response to conventional treatments. Without a doubt, having a mental health diagnosis and the appropriate pharmaceutical tools to support it can be incredible and life-saving, especially for stabilizing someone in the short term. But are they enough? Or even necessary? for long-term or preventative care? These questions ignited my passion for rethinking mental health care. I became fascinated about the mind-body connection, the root causes of diseases, and the wisdom found in tribal and Eastern medicine techniques. When I wasn't working, I was reading, studying, and applying what I could to my own life. I could feel my health improving and began searching for opportunities to expand my knowledge. In 2022, I was incredibly fortunate to be accepted into a PhD program here in Australia, where I'm currently deepening my studies in brain and mental health. We've been told that mental health issues are a genetic, chemical destiny, a fixed trait. But that's actually inaccurate in our least hopeful narrative about mental health. We hear a lot about mental health, but how often do we hear about brain health? The brain's the part of the body that supports the mind. A healthy brain supports a healthy mind, that's the foundation. However, when we address mental health, we often overlook the brain. Have you ever thought about it? If someone has a lung issue, we examine the lungs. If there's a problem with the heart, we investigate the heart. If the bones, the liver are affected, we evaluate them. But when there's something affecting the mind, we typically rely on subjective questionnaires to make a diagnosis. We make assumptions about what might be happening chemically in the brain of someone showing symptoms of depression, anxiety, ADHD, and we treat that without incorporating any biological data. An approach that prioritizes the brain as the foundation of mental health care is fascinating because the brain has the ability to change. These changes can be measured objectively, guiding us doctors to develop personalized approaches that meet the specific needs of each individual's brain and mind. If the brain can change, and a healthy brain supports a healthy mind, then there may be other possibilities for people to improve their mental well-being by taking care of their brains. This offers a way more hopeful narrative about mental health, and can actually begin with very simple choices. Here are three realistic healthy habits for busy people to consider adding to their morning routine to support their brains. First, drink water. How many of us drink coffee before drinking water in the morning? Supporting your brain can start as simple as drinking a glass of water after waking up. About 80% of the brain is made up of water. In fact, studies have shown that even a mild dehydration can impair cognitive function, affect focus, memory, and overall mental clarity. When we wake up in the morning, we are dehydrated, so drink water. Second, sunlight. Viewing morning sunlight as soon as possible after waking up for a few minutes. The sunlight is detected by specialized cells in our eyes that send signals to our brains, helping to regulate cortisol levels, improve alertness during the day, and sleep later that night. Also, this simple morning light exposure increases dopamine production in the brain, boosting our mood, our focus, our ability to learn and retain information. Third, avoid using your phone first thing in the morning. I know, it can be a challenge. You know when you turn on your computer and it takes a moment for the system to actually start? Our brains are very similar. They need time after waking up to be ready to process information. When you wake up and even before leaving the bed, grab your phone and start scrolling or answering messages, you bypass crucial brainwave stages. And this can set your brain up for a distraction and stress throughout the day. What can you do instead? Drink water, enjoy the sunlight, fresh air, take a shower, move your body, meditate, journal, do a gratitude practice. Allowing your brain to be fully awake before stimulating it with fast-paced content, before responding to external demands, can make a huge difference. As you know, we are very unique, very complex beings, and many other factors can influence the mind-body connection. How you're sleeping, how you're feeding yourselves, whether or not we are moving our bodies, the degree to which we have inflammatory molecules in our bloodstream, our gut health, our ability to manage stress, then also other elements. Do we have unresolved trauma? Do we have community in our lives? Do we wake up with a sense of meaning and purpose? Do we have pleasure, play? Do we feel safe to express ourselves? Are we fulfilled in our relationships? Do we know and respect our boundaries? These are also very real determinants of our mental health. A personalized medicine approach that values the mind-body connection, that investigates and supports the whole person instead of just treating a diagnosis, offers hope in the form of options. It empowers people not only to go through life with less suffering, but to actually enjoy life.